case. According to a major economist and political scientist, Mancure Olson, there are three conditions for economic growth, for a country to be competitive, to be economically successful: free markets, a framework, an institutional framework that is suitable for economic development, an efficient institutional framework. And the third, very important thing is political elites who understand the basic economic ideas, tools, and concepts. This is also very crucial. Let's start with markets. I feel that I don't have to persuade you. However, usually we're speaking of successful free market economies in the first, let's say, in the developed economies. However, there are some numbers that are spectacular about the success of free markets. These are the numbers of the poverty reduction in the third world from 1990 to 2010. Almost 1 billion people escaped extreme poverty because of the globalization. The amount of people who suffer poverty, extreme poverty, less than 1.19 US dollars per day, escaped poverty, the poverty trap, because of the liberalization, mostly of trade between countries. And this trend continued from 2010 to 2015, according to the projections for the end of 2015. This number fell to 7 million people in the world. 200 million people in addition of the 1 billion number that I mentioned before. You can see the impact of free trade and free markets at this pie chart, these two pie charts. I repeat that people, almost 27-28% of the total world population escaped extreme poverty because of free trade. Of course, there were areas in the world, especially in East Asia, mostly because of the liberalization of the economy in China, that were more successful. However, even in sub-Saharan Africa, the improvement was as spectacular as a fall of 35% in people in extreme poverty, even though sub-Saharan Africa is less successful than East Asia. You don't have to know. You can send me an email and I can send you these slides, so you don't have to take notes. So, a myth, a very prevalent myth, is that supposedly free market comes with inequality. No. As you can see in this graph, the 50 least economically free countries are a lot more unequal in comparison with the 50 most economically free countries. Actually, this is a graph that represents the income share of the poorest 10% in national economies and its correlation with economic freedom. As you can see, to be the most free quartile is much better than to be in any other quartile. And this is in relative terms. But if you see the same graph in absolutist, let's say, terms, you will realize that the income of the poorest 10% in more economically free countries are a lot more than in any other kind of country in the world. So, free market means less inequality, more income for the poor. So, if you want to eradicate poverty, if you want to improve inequality, trade liberalization is, as economists have put it, a no-brainer. You should liberalize trade, you should liberalize the economy, and then you have a number of other tools to improve the situation, especially in the third world. Mostly access to contraception, you can understand why. There is a strong correlation of economic freedom with political freedom, with subjective well-being as reported by the people themselves, with the what Rawls, John Rawls would call natural lottery. It is much better to for your children to be born in a free economy rather than in an economy that is not free, etc. However, we should also emphasize that free economy is the necessary condition, as I think that Martin has emphasized, we do not have a strong welfare state without capitalism, if I'm not mistaken. However, targeted, well-targeted social benefits are also very important, because these targeted social benefits, a genuine welfare state, can function as a magnified glass, because with the money, with the amount of money that we have gathered from free trade and from the growth, you can you can greatly improve the lot of the poorest people in your society. So there is a consensus right now among the economists that says that an open economy, well, meaning efficiently regulated, with a well, again, efficiently targeted social benefits, is the ideal state. And I think that Denmark is a very good example. Now, about the institutions. The economic analysis of institutions is the product of the work of many economists, starting from Ronald Coase, and after Ronald Coase, Douglas North. Unfortunately, Douglas North died last night, if I'm not mistaken. I think it was last night. So I'd like to dedicate this speech to his memory. He was one of the most important economists, the Nobel laureate. According to Douglas North, Douglas North was the first economist to establish this strong correlation between economic growth and institutional framework. According to Douglas North, the rule of law, high quality regulation, and open markets were necessary. This book, it's the best book that you can read about the subject, very concise book. Or alternatively, you can read this book written by Daron Acemoglu and James Robinson about the same topic, the importance of efficient institutions. However, we should make a very interesting distinction between formal institutions, that is law, and informal institutions, social norms, especially trust. According to Acemoglu and Robinson, institutions can be extractive, can be bad institutions, and inclusive institutions. Inclusive economic institutions are secure property rights, contracts, law and order, market and state support for public services, open to relatively free entry of new businesses, access to education opportunity for the great majority of citizens, incentives for investment, innovation, and the level playing field, etc. And extractive institutions, the totally opposite. Politics. Politics are very important. The worst thing, as the Junger quote emphasized before, is that clientelism, and is especially the fact that politicians have contradicting incentives. They want to be re-elected, and at the same time, they understand, at least some of them who want to be statesmen, they understand the importance of pursuing policies that are unpopular. Because of the, especially of a political class that is not economically literate, we have this distortion of the things that we mentioned before. Instead, for example, of a welfare state, we have a state that is a kind of spoil for strong public sector unions. Let's say we have very strong big businesses, closed shops, and public sector unions who are actually the real enemies of the market. And we have this distortion that I described before, because instead of equal opportunity, you have a kind of redistribution, a zero-sum game. Instead of regulation, you have efficient regulation, you have government failure. Instead of protecting and investing in public goods, you have rent-seeking. And instead of the rule of law, you have chronic capitalism. This is a disgraceful graph that illustrates what I'm saying. As you can see, let's start with the case of Germany.
where Germany?
Germany. As you can see, in Germany, the German state, the German welfare state, spends the same amount of money for the top, for the highest quantile and the lowest quantile in social benefits. So this graph is disgraceful for Germany. The Slovak Republic is doing, I think, a better job than the German welfare state, because the lowest quantile receives a bigger amount of money in social benefits in cash from the highest quantile. Of course, the most efficient welfare states, where the social benefits are targeted to the poor, to the people in need, and not to the strong, powerful, pressure groups, are the Scandinavian countries and Australia, Canada, countries with a traditional welfare state. Now, let's see what happens with Greece. As you can see, the highest quantile in Greece received as late as 2011 through 3.5 times more than the lowest quantile. This is certainly a redistribution. There is a redistribution here, but it is a redistribution from the lowest quantile to the highest quantile. It is a redistribution from the poor to the rich. Okay. Going as fast as I can into the Greek case, I'll try to apply in 5 minutes these ideas into the Greek case. First of all, Greece is not a free market economy. And in this way, you can explain why the European crisis hit Greece so hard. Greece is not a free market economy according to all the rankings. I also added the numbers for Slovakia, for you to have a reference point. Can you spot Greece? This is the neighborhood of Greece. Greece is between, Niger and Bangladesh. It is not a free market economy. It is characterized as a mostly unfree economy. The Greek institutions, we have a bloated, inefficient welfare state. We saw before why. Tax evasion is considered a social right for a lot of people in Greece. We have a hugely inefficient public sector, corruption that it is tolerated by the Greek society. We have public sector unions that are very powerful, closed professions, overregulation. This is an example of the Greek extractive institutions, extractive using the concepts created by Acemoglu and Robinson. And as you can see, the situation is getting worse. This is the number of regulations that are in enforcement now in Greece, that have been enforced in Greece from 1974 to 2005. It's more than 200,000 regulations of different kind. We have a justice system that is totally inefficient. How much inefficient? You need 1,580 days to enforce a contract in Greece, almost 1,600 days. You can see the numbers for Slovakia. This means 4 years and a half. This also means that contracts are not enforced in Greece. So you can understand why someone could be very reluctant to invest in Greece, because it is very difficult to enforce even a contract in Greece. And as you can see, and this is a list of the reforms undertook by the Greek state to deal with this problem. The problem in Greece is not only that it is very difficult to establish a contractual relationship because of the non-enforcement of contracts, there is another problem, that it is a parallel problem. It is also very difficult for a firm, for a business entity, to die, to go bankrupt, to go into insolvency. It is so difficult that according to this graph that was published by economists, this is the worst combination of the two factors for a country. Actually, this was a graph that was published in an article with the title "Where Not to Invest in Europe," with Greece having the first place a year ago. So you need 4 years and a half to enforce a contract. You need 3 years and a half to finish this bankruptcy procedure. So businesses in Greece, it's very difficult for a business to be born in Greece, and at the same time, it's very difficult for a business to die in Greece. Actually, Greek businesses become something like a zombie without having any way of extricating themselves from this situation. There is a lack of social norms. There is an absence of civil society. Actually, civil society cannot be translated to Greek because there is it is difficult to translate because there is no civil society. You can see in graffiti, you can see, for example, this is a part of my very huge, vast collection of Greek parking. And as you can see, this is a car. Actually, this is a car by someone who teaches how to drive. A car belonging to a driving school. And of course, this is a police car parking at the handicap spot. An indication of low level of social norms, a very strong indication, is the low levels of trust. The level of trust in Greece is comparable to levels of trust in African economies, unfortunately. The result of this situation, there is a correlation between social spending and social benefits and having an inefficient welfare state with a crisis, as you can see in this graph. It is not a coincidence that that pension spending in Greece is is higher than in every other country in this graph. And I think that you can also spot the Slovak Republic in this graph, if I'm not mistaken. Yeah, Slovakia. Slovakia is doing very well. Or the percent of population reliant on public funding. Again, Greece is a champion. So, even though after 5 years of devastating austerity in Greece and a rather steep drop in the labor cost, actually, if we compare the decline in labor cost in Greece and in Germany, and the increase in Germany, we will imagine that Greece became more competitive because of this decline. However, as you can see in this graph, the unemployment in Greece has reached, devastating heights. Unemployment in Greece is now almost 30%, 60% among young people. We have a tremendous brain drain because of that. More than 200,000 Greek young men and women left Greece. And we have a fall in living standards that is devastating. You should only remember one number. From 2007 to 2015, Greek GDP per capita fell by 28%. 28% means only one thing, war. Only after a war you have such a steep decline in GDP. Not only that, the austerity that was enforced in Greece was of the wrong mix. There are two, let's say, categories of austerity policies. Austerity policies emphasizing spending cuts and austerity policies emphasizing tax hikes. Unfortunately, because of the Greek political class and its economic literacy, the Greek, not only economic literacy, but also because of the fear of the political cost, the Greek political class decided that the best austerity mix was an austerity mix emphasizing tax hikes, and this was catastrophic for Greece. Thank you very much.